I'll just invite her to come up. You know who she is, Chloe. Please come up.
The last in Psalm 2, verse 12. So in the last verse of Psalm 2, it says, how blessed are those who take refuge in Him. So Psalm 1 opens with how blessed, and Psalm 2 ends with how blessed. And therefore, Psalm 1 and Psalm 2 are to be read together. Do you see that? How to be happy? Verse 1 talks about four verbs, four knots. The man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. So the three verbs, walk, sit, and stand, there is a progressive movement in those three verbs. You see that? When we choose to walk in a way, we choose a direction. And when we stand there, that means we reached our destination. And when we sit there, that means we're already settled down. So a blessed person, a happy person, is to choose your life direction at the very beginning. Choose it wisely. And then verse 2 talks about what we should do. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. Delight means joyful. When we read God's word, do you feel joy in your heart? Reading God's word should not be like a duty, or we have to do this as a routine. It should bring you joy. That should be the right way of reading God's word. And then law, in Hebrew, is Torah. Torah means instruction. It means teaching. It means God's finger pointing a way for his people to walk in it. So law in the Old Testament does not just mean like law and grace. It doesn't have any negative sense. God's law means God's word. And then the word meditate. Meditate doesn't mean silent meditation. It means thinking out loud. It means when you read God's word, you ask questions. Like, what does this mean? What does this verse mean to me today? What does it mean by delighting in God's word? And how do I delight in God's word? So you interact with scripture and you meditate upon the word of God. And do you know the word meditate in verse 2 is the same word that appears in Psalm 2, verse 1. Psalm 2, verse 1 says, why are the nations in an uproar and the peoples devising a vain thing? The word devising is the same word for meditate. So what does this mean? If we read the two Psalms together, these two words are the same. That means instead of devising or plotting vain things, we should meditate God's word. Does it make sense? Someone doesn't tell us the benefit of reading God's law, but another Torah psalm, Psalm 19, tells us the benefits of reading God's law. The law of the Lord is perfect, restoring the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. What is the condition of your soul this morning? Do you want your soul to be restored? Do you want to be simple? The simple doesn't mean naive. The simple means pure. And what is the condition of your heart? Do you want your heart to be rejoiced? And what about your eyes? Do you want your eyes to be enlightened? If your response is yes to all those questions, then the answer is reading God's law. Psalm 119 is the longest psalm, which is a Torah psalm. There are 176 verses, all in alphabetical order. So there are 22 paragraphs, each start with a Hebrew alphabet. So this is a masterpiece in literature. In the beginning two verses of Psalm 119, he uses the same word as in Psalm 1, how blessed. How blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. How blessed are those who observe his testimonies, who seek him with all their heart. Someone doesn't tell us someone 19 supplements what someone does not finish. We need to delight in God's law, but we also need to observe to keep God's law as well. And if we do that, verse 3 gives us a metaphor. He will be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither, and in whatever he does, he prospers. These plants are in the front porch of our house. They're still the same. Actually, there's one more, right? One more pot, and it looks just like the rest of it. What's going on here? There used to be green. There used to be a basil in there. I forgot which pot is basil. And there is a mint. And there is a green onion that I planted. But now it's been like that for months. I was hoping someone would take care of it. But so one time I told a coworker at work, because she was one of the person who gave me one of the pots, one of the plants. So I asked her, I said, oh, I'm sorry, the plant that you gave me died because I've been too busy, I didn't have time to water it. So I asked her, next time when you give me a plant, can you give me a plant that only needs to be watered once a month? Yeah. Guess what she said to me? She said, can you eat once a month? Don't you think she's wise? Of course we cannot eat just once a month. We need to eat every day. Our bodies need sustenance. Our bodies need food. Our souls need food as well. Our souls need God's word. What is this tree? What is this tree that the psalmist talks about? This tree has leaves and does not wither. This tree is like an evergreen tree. Where in the Bible does this tree appear? Yes. In Genesis 2, there is a tree of life in the middle of the garden. And then there is also a river flowed out of Eden to water the garden. And so the Garden of Eden is like God's sanctuary, like God's temple, with the presence of God, with the tree of life, and with the source of water. It would be something like this. I really like this picture. With water, do you see that in the back? And with this beautiful tree, and with some other animals. The tree of life also appears in the vision of Ezekiel. In the vision of Ezekiel, he saw this end time temple, and then he described what he saw. He said, then he brought me back to the door of the house, and this house refers to God's temple. And behold, water was flowing from under the threshold of the house toward the east. And then later on it says, whenever the water flows, there will have the living beings. And then there is also the tree here by the river on its bank. On one side and on the other will grow all kinds of trees for food. That means they're fruit trees. Their leaves will not wither and their fruit will not fail. Does it sound like a tree in someone? Yes? And then the water flows from the sanctuary and their fruit will be for food and their leaves for healing. So in Ezekiel's temple vision, there is a river of life. There is the tree of life. And then the leaves of the trees will be for healing. The tree of life also appears in the very last chapter of the Bible, in the book of Revelations. This is what John saw in his vision. Then he showed me a river of the water of life, clear as crystal, coming from the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the middle of its street, on either side of the river, was the tree of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Do you see this tree of life in the end time temple? So both the temple in revelation is that the leaves for these two visions have healing power. But then there's no mention of healing in the tree of life in the Garden of Eden. Why is that? Do you understand the question? Because in Genesis 2, sin has not entered human race yet. That's why there is no healing involved. Now try to see this picture with a tree planted by the streams of water. So if someone who delights in God's law, he will be like this tree, and then the water will be like the law of the Lord. The next three verses talk about the wicked. The wicked are not so, but they are like chaff which the wind drives away. Last Sunday, Pastor Eddie talked about Gideon the chicken, that he was winnowing the wheat inside the wine press. You remember that? So it's the same image of winnowing the wheat. And then when the wind blows off the chaff, and the chaff will be blown away. And so the last two verses, therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, not sinners in the assembly of the righteous. Because the wicked are like chaff. They have no weight. They are not like a tree planted by a stream of water. And therefore they cannot stand in the assembly of the righteous. Last verse, for the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. When we read someone, let me ask, how many of you can memorize someone? Anyone? One person? Two? Very good. I think we are familiar with the content of someone. Someone talks about two ways, two lives, two characters, two metaphors, and two results. There is no middle ground in these two songs. There are only two kinds of people. One is righteous, the other one is wicked. And the righteous person is someone who loves God's word, and the wicked person is someone who does not love God's word. So someone, the key to happiness is delighting in God's law. If we find joy in reading God's word, then we are happy people. And delighting in God's law means forsaking the way of the wicked. Don't even go in that direction. Don't even walk in that path. I have three illustrations. The first one is Star Wars. Imagine, do you know the name of the guy that you see? Anakin Skywalker. Okay. And what happened to him later on? He becomes Darth Vader. So we try to read someone into Anakin Skywalker. So because of his hatred, his pride, his jealousy, he slowly, gradually turned to the dark side, right? But then if he were a Christian, if he loved God's word, do you think he would ever become like Darth Vader? Not just like he would become Darth Vader. No, right? No. And so the helmet, the mask, the outfit of Darth Vader symbolizes the loss of humanity in Anakin Skywalker. The second illustration is Beauty and the Beast. How many of you have seen this movie? Do you like it? The Beast, he was a handsome prince before. And then because of his pride and lack of love for other people, the witch turned him into a beast. But later on, when he started to have love for the beauty and then sacrificed for her, and then he returned into a handsome prince again. So if you try to read someone into the Beauty and the Beast, that means if we don't have love, then we will become like a beast. Does it work? Is it working? Okay, that's just my imagination. Now, the third illustration is not from the movies, it's from the Bible. Do you know which story it's about? The third picture. know, he was a human being and God turned him into a beast, literally, for 7 years. So one day, King Nebuchadnezzar was walking on the roof of his palace, and then he looked at his kingdom, and then he said, "Is this Babylon the Great, which I have built by my power for my glory?" And right after that, he turned into a beast. This is a painting. If you go to Paris in the museum, the Louvre, you'll see this painting there. So the head looks like a human. You see that? It's long, mane, and with a beast kind of body. Now, we may not turn into a robot or a beast if we don't read God's word. We may look the same, but what about the way we treat other people? What about the words that come out from our mouth? What about our temper? All those things can reflect that we may not become a beast in our body, but we may become a beast spiritually. So how do we delight in God's law? We need to spend time. There is no other way around it. If you love something, you need to spend time. I've known two people who memorized 150 songs. Can you believe it? 150 songs, they memorized all of them. And when I heard that, I just feel that it's very inspiring. I don't know if it's possible for me to do that, but I try to memorize some of the significant songs. And then we need to meditate, we need to reflect, and I would encourage you to journal and to draw. I know Joel has are you doing it now, right now? No, not yet. You have a journal, right? And then you draw, and then you write your notes. I think that's a very good way to interact with God's word. If you're a visual person, I would encourage you to draw. And then keep learning. There is no graduating from God's word. Even if you get a PhD in the Bible, even if you have been teaching for 50 years, we don't know anything about God's word. When I was studying at Dallas Theological Seminary, one of my professors, whose name is Howard Hendricks, he told us, he said, "The day you stop learning is the day you stop teaching." And that statement has been influencing me, shaping my philosophy of teaching. So keep learning. There is a Chinese proverb which says, "If you don't read for 3 days, you become ugly." For those who know Chinese, you know what I'm talking about. Okay? But I think we can apply it to God's word too. If we don't read God's word in 3 days, we'll become ugly in our temper, in our speech, in the way we treat other people. So read God's word. Now, this is what I drew. Can you tell what that is? I'm a visual person, so sometimes when I read scripture, when there are a lot of details, I want to draw them out. So this is from Exodus chapter 28. It describes the garment of the priest. Do you know it is blue color? And there are layers and vests. And when I read the scripture and when I draw this picture, I find out, oh, the priests, they don't wear socks. And then they don't wear shoes. Because I was looking for it in the scripture. It's not there. That means they were barefooted when they entered the sanctuary or the tabernacle. And do you know there are bells around the hem of their robe? Can you make the sound of the bells? Okay. Thank you for trying. I think it's more fun if you try to draw scripture. And then you notice the details. When I teach Hebrew at school, then I would encourage students to color the Bible as well. For example, God's name I'll color red, people's name I'll color in green, and then numbers will be yellow. And so if you color sacred. We cannot mark it or color it. I suggest you to have more than one Bible. One can be for your coloring, and the other one is just for not coloring. All right, Psalm 1 and Psalm 2. Both Psalms introduce the whole book of the Psalms. So both Psalms form an introduction, a prelude, because the word blessed linked the two Psalms. And there are no subtitles, no the Psalm of David, like that, nothing like that. And then there are many shared vocabulary and images, even though the contents of these two Psalms seem very different. If Psalm 1 represents the law, then Psalm 2 represents the prophets, because the themes of kingship, judgment, and Gentiles are all in Psalm 2. So now let's read Psalm 2 together. Let's read the first three verses. Why are the nations in an uproar, and the peoples devising a vain thing? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us tear their fetters apart and cast away their cords from us. So there are kings, there are nations who gather together to plot against the Lord and his anointed. So this is what's happening. Now when we think about the rulers of the world, like these two guys, I don't know what you think about them. I see a lot of smiles, huh? I don't know what that means. But then, sometimes when we see our worldly rulers, we may not have that kind of respect, such as for these two guys. And so when God sees the earthly kings back then, he had the same response. He laughed at them. He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. Then he will speak to them in his anger and terrify them in his fury, saying, but as for me, I have installed my king upon Zion, my holy mountain. So God was laughing at the earthly kings because they attempted to plot against him and his anointed. But God said, I have already installed my king upon my mountain. And then the next couple of verses is written from the perspective of the anointed. He said, I will surely tell of the decree of the Lord. He said to me, you are my son, today I have begotten you. Back then, a king is like God's adopted son. Verse 8, ask of me, and I will surely give the nations as your inheritance. The nations refers back to Psalm 2, verse 1. And the very ends of the earth as your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron. You shall shatter them like earthen. So basically, God's saying to his anointed, you will win over all the earthly kings. Now the last couple verses, let's read them together. Now therefore, O kings, show discernment. Take warning, O judges of the earth. Worship the Lord with reverence, and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, that he not become angry, and you perish in the way, for his wrath may soon be kindled. How blessed are all who take refuge in him. So the last couple verses of Psalm 2 basically is a charge to the earthly kings to kiss the Son. Now, what does it mean by kiss the Son? Another translation is bow down or worship the Son. That's basically what it means, kiss the Son. So back then, people would kiss the feet of the kings as a way to show reverence, as a way to show respect. And here, what's interesting in verse 12 is that the word son was not written in Hebrew. In Hebrew, the word son is ben. Ben, B-E-N, everybody knows that word, right? But in Aramaic, it's bar, and right here is the word Aramaic. And Aramaic was an international language at the time. And so here, the author, by using an Aramaic word for the word son, he implies that this son is not just this, the anointed for the Hebrews, for the Israelites, but for all. So at the end, he closes with, how blessed are all who take refuge in him. If we divide Psalm 2 into three parts, verses 1 to 4 will be contrast between the earthly kings versus the Lord and his anointed. The middle part, verse his inheritance, and the last couple verses will be the charge to the earthly kings to kiss the son. We have to know that when Psalm 2 was written, people did not know who the anointed was referring to, because Jesus hasn't come yet. But then the author of the New Testament, they would read Psalm 2 as referring to Jesus. Here is an example. We have been studying the book of Acts. This is an example of the disciples. Verse 27, it says, "For truly in this city there were gathered together against their holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the people of Israel." So in the New Testament context, the Gentile king Herod and Pontius Pilate, they plot against Jesus. And so the disciples quoted Psalm 2 as referring to the fulfillment in Acts 4. Does that make sense? Okay. In the two, okay, let's keep going. Acts 13, this is another quote from Psalm 2. This is what Paul said, basically quoting Psalm 2, "You are my son today, I have begotten you," referring to Jesus. So Psalm 2 is a royal psalm, it's a kingship psalm, it is also a messianic psalm. It's concerns about national rather than individual. And then there are also two groups of being, the earthly kings and the Lord and his anointed. So earlier I said the contents of Psalm 1 and Psalm 2 are very different, but they also share similarities. So this is a table I made, writing down all the same vocabulary that appear in Psalm 1 and Psalm 2. So we talked about the word blessed, and then we talked about the word meditate and plot, they are the same word in Hebrew, and the word sit appears in both Psalm 1 and Psalm 2, and give, judgment, judge, perish, and the world. All he does will prosper, or whoever he does will prosper, it's not there. But anyways, do you see the similarities in vocabulary of these two psalms? And because of that, these two psalms are to be read together. There are a few interactions between Psalm 1 and Psalm 2 if we read them together. The first interaction is the law and the king. What is the relationship between the law and the king? Can someone tell me? Okay, let's look at this verse. In Deuteronomy 17, it's about the law for the king. So when the king becomes king, he was supposed to write for himself a copy of the law, and then read it, and then ask people to observe it. I think that's a good idea for me next time when I design an assignment for my students. I should let the students copy the Bible, or copy a book that I'm teaching, rather than make a cell phone copy, digital copy of it, but a handwritten copy. When we write God's law, in the process of writing, we'll remember God's law. So the success of the king depends on how he keeps God's law. Do you see the relationship between the law and the king? And that's another example is in King Josiah. During his reign, the book of the law was found, and then he made a covenant with the people to observe the law. Another interaction between Psalm 1 and Psalm 2 is the word blessed. In Psalm 1 it says, blessed are those who delight in the law of the Lord. And Psalm 2 says, blessed is the one who takes refuge in his son. And so we can say that the law leads one to take refuge in the son. When Jesus died and resurrected, he appeared to his disciples and he said to them, he said, "These are my words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things which are written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." When Jesus read the Psalms point to Jesus. The law leads one to take refuge in the Son, because these two cannot be separate, are not separable. Another interaction between Psalm 1 that some tool redefines the meaning of the wicked and perish in someone. Someone says the wicked will perish. If we read Psalm 2, which means those who do not take refuge in the sun will perish. And this is in line with John 3:16. Those who believe in Jesus will not perish. Those who do not believe in Jesus will perish. We see the interactions between them. And so for some of us here, we may not accept Jesus as our personal savior yet. Maybe we think that being a Christian is to come to church. This shouldn't be it. We have to make a personal proclamation to claim that Jesus is our Lord in order to be saved. And so applications. Psalm 1 and Psalm 2, which if they were written after the exile, the whole book of Psalms was composed after the exile. And during this time, the law was very important. So if you read Ezra and Nehemiah, it's all about God's law. And to rebuild a nation, to rebuild a family, to rebuild a church, we need God's law. And during this time, the messianic expectation was very great as well, because the second temple was being built, but then the real kingdom of God was not realized yet. So the concept of already but not yet still stands during this time, and also in our time as well. If we see our world, do you think God's kingdom is here? No? Yes? It's yes and no. It's already but not yet. So for those who have submitted ourselves to the Lordship of Jesus, then God's kingdom has been realized in our own lives. And if our church as a whole are submitting our future to God and to do what he wants us to do, then God's kingdom has been realized here in our church. But then when we look around the world is not perfect. There are terrorists, there are disease, there is a moral decline, there are a lot of pains and suffering. Take, for example, the Syrian refugees. According to the statistics, there are 65 million people who belong to this term forced migration or forced displacement. And out of the 65 million people, 11 million of them are from Syria. So they are all over the world, in Europe and some in San Diego, right? And I'm so glad that our church is involved in this mission. I'm so glad. And then Myanmar has a crisis going on as well. There is a Rohingya Muslim minority in this country, and then they were being expelled and killed, and the number was scary. So on the way to other countries, people would die of hunger. Right now, maybe we're thinking what to eat for lunch or dinner, and sometimes when I'm too full, I have to take a walk in order to relieve the food coma. But then there are people nowadays who are starved to death. So when we look at this humanitarian crisis, we may feel powerless or just too far away from us. But then just imagine if you and I are one of them, how would you think about this crisis? Violence against humanity is violence against God. So God's kingdom is not realized in our world yet. And because of that, we need missions. And I'm so glad UCLA has a lot of teams going on missions this summer. It cannot go wrong if we participate in God's mission, because that's where God's heart is. To conclude, Psalm 1 and Psalm 2 teach us to delight in God's word, to submit to God's Son, and to participate in God's kingdom. Which area, God's word, God's Son, and God's kingdom, do you think you need to grow? Do you spend time to be God's word? Do you submit at all areas of your life to Jesus? And are you participating in the missions of God in some way? What would be your response? Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your Son, who has died for us so that we can have hope in your kingdom and eternal life as well. And I pray for everyone here in this room that your word will speak to our heart and help us to respond to you. Help us to live a life pleasing to you and help us to rejoice in your word, in the salvation of your Son, and to be rejoiced in being a part of your kingdom. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
So come forward as you continue to worship God, giving you our tithes and offerings. And I want to serve you. God, I'm just sort of up to you. This little bit of money that we have given to you, God, may it be used for your kingdom's sake and to be able to share the gospel all around the world. So thank you for your Jesus' name. Sing I See Heaven as a response song. Stand with me. I see heaven invading this place. I see angels praising your holy name. I sing praises, I sing praises, give you honor, worthy Jesus. I see glory falling in this place. I see hope restored, the healing of all disease. I sing praises, I sing praises. Give you honor, worthy Jesus. We give you praise, all of the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God. We give you praise, all of the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. I see glory falling in this place. I see hope restored, the healing of all disease. I sing praises, I sing praises. I give you honor, worthy Jesus. We give you praise, all of the honor. You are our God. The glory, God. this week. May we remember, God, to read your word, God, to listen to you.